Okay, I've been joined today by Simon Roth, the lead designer on Maia, a very interesting game about space exploration and base building. Can you tell us a little bit about it?
It's a space colony management sim. If you need to compare it to other games, it's a mashup somewhere between The Sims, Dungeon Keeper, and Dwarf Fortress. It's got the management of and the UI of kind of Dungeon Keeper feel, but it's got the crazy simulation and depth that you'd want from a game like Dwarf Fortress. You're colonizing an alien planet, and the world that you're inhabiting is incredibly hostile. It's hard sci-fi, so we're using real science, a real planet that's now actually been discovered based on the science that we used to calculate where it would be. And we're basically making what is an incredibly intense simulator. Every grass, a little bit of grass on the ground is growing based on the sunlight that hits it and the rain. Every colonist in your colony is a fully simulated human being down to their heart rate and what's going on in their mind. And we're kind of simulating emotions and things like this. The complexity of the game is insane, but at the same time, I'm trying to keep it as accessible as possible. There's no crazy UI with lots of things. There's three buttons. Use the mouse, use a few keyboard commands if you want some extra things. And yeah, the game's, it's simple and complex and has, we're going for a lot of character. Rather than making something that's perhaps dry and management-based, we've got dark humor. It's very British. We'll definitely be getting all the tax breaks for British games. We've got, jokes about tea and lots of kind of very Douglas Adams feeling stuff. And yeah, that's the quick pitch for the game, sorry.
I've heard people talk likening Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy. I've played the game. I've saw the Dungeon Keeper chickens and that kind of stuff. There's a lot of homage in there. And I think I spoke to one of your colleagues and they mentioned Theme Hospital as well. So a definite Bullfrog influence, would you say?
I'm very inspired by Bullfrog. Bullfrog created a lot of games when there wasn't a template to work from. A lot of games now, they see, we've got to use this language, this game design language that's been built up. You can't build a shooter which doesn't exactly look like COD because it has to look like Call of Duty, or like a management game that doesn't look like, well, to be fair, there aren't any management games now, but people use these kind of obvious things. But when Bullfrog were doing it, they didn't. They just came up with what they wanted on the spot. They solved these problems and they did it in really interesting ways that you wouldn't have immediately done. And that's kind of what I'm trying to do, is I try and solve every problem as it arises. In Maia, we're going to have them literally showing their emotions through subtle animations and things. You're going to have to look at what's happening in the game and understand the world, not just rely on a readout. No one has a health bar in the world, but you can see all their vital stats and you can actually learn some medicine from it. You can learn what it means when different heart waves are doing different things on an electrocardiogram. You don't need these things, because I also show them in a more subtle way. We have sound. We have a very nice sound system that's fully 3D and will kind of hint you things. And also everything is visually shown. So if something's damaged, it's smoking, and something's broken, or if someone's angry, they'll be emoting it gently, and you'll see that they're doing everything in a slightly more rigid, frustrated way. And also, of course, Bullfrog made the funniest games. And it's creativity. Allowing the player to be creative with what they want to make. Our tutorial here isn't particularly prescriptive and you can just skip it. And the first thing that, a kid earlier, he just turned around to me and goes, "So how do I kill everyone?" And I was that's not really the point of the game. And he goes, "No, I want to kill everyone though." And I went, "Well, I guess you could asphyxiate them." And he goes, "Yes, that's what I want." That's not something you can plan for as a games designer, but it's the fact is people can play it in their own way and they can try things out and they can experiment with the game. That with everything being simulated, things do react to each other in different ways, and things that you weren't expecting just happen. And even bugs are a lot more entertaining when it's in a system that's simulating things, because really weird stuff happens and colonists. One of our bugs now is when colonists die in a spacesuit, they're supposed to ham it up and do a horrible death animation. But there's a bug in the code that I was doing the night before, and one of the colonists died, and he died just standing up in his suit, slumped his head forward, and was just standing there. And someone came up and goes, my colonist has died standing up. And then another colonist died standing up. And he just had this creepy graveyard of dead people just stand like half dead. And I went, okay, well, you know, for bugs in other game, just crash it to desktop or whatever. But in Maia, creepy stuff happens. So that's great.
What about the characters of the colonists then? How you mentioned the Sims. How is that going to manifest itself? And what kind of behaviours are people going to see from the characters?
So everything about them is simulated, and so they have emotions. They learn things. They learn things about each other. We've got at the moment there's not much of it showing. We don't have the animations to show it, but there are some very subtle things in. We've got things like social awkwardness. When you're playing the game, you might have seen that if someone's working on an object and someone else walked into the room wanting to use that object, they'll stop, pause, and look around a bit, and then go, oh, I'm yawning, and then kind of wander out the room again, instead of having to interact with that person to ask them to use the object. And that we've got cats in the game, highly apathetic cats, characters will like learn relationships of who they like and who they dislike. And if one of your characters becomes psychotic, which is highly possible, you might have seen a few kind of procedural emails that they send you. They're kind of relating back their state to you. It's a good way, because we don't have facial animation, it's a good way to relate their characters back to you. It's by having them send you little progress reports. And we've got ones where they go nuts and send you little haikus. But at the same time, the emotions will vary. And we've got animations for people playing with the dogs now. And we're going to have... Well, this is a feature that may have to be cut. But if someone really dislikes a person, and you can accidentally set destruct orders on people as well as objects. And if you set a destruct order on a person and they go to sleep, and someone who doesn't like them very much is in the room, they might follow through on that order by putting their hand over their mouth while they're sleeping and quietly euthanizing them. There's a whole range. But at the same time, we've got, like, they'll be happy and they'll show happiness, and they might become too happy and then become, like, a bit cocky about things and do things dangerously. At the moment, they make decisions based on their wants and needs. And those also include like their emotional needs. The lighting affects them in the game as well. This is also one of the reasons why I had to write my own engine, because I wanted to be able to get the amount of light to any pixel on screen. And so if they're in a well-lit room, they'll get less fatigued. If they're in a room that's very red, they might get more aggressive. They'll do their work faster, but they'll use up more energy. If you make your base very blue and kind of chilled out, they'll get chilled out, they'll use less energy, and they'll breathe less air, but they'll do less work. So you can trade things off just by tweaking the lighting in the base. And it's all these kind of little details that are completely impossible to show people at a game show. But all these kind of very, very little things that make the game kind of interesting above and beyond any other just quick simulation game or just a management game where, you know, the people are just drones. At the moment, like, people can get caught in like shame spirals where they don't do anything, and because they don't do anything, their mental state becomes worse, and they don't do anything even more, and so they get even worse and worse and worse. And like, occasionally you have a colonist who will just get out of bed, go eat some food, have a drink, get back in bed, and just stay there. And the thing is, people report this stuff as bugs, and I'm like, no, he's just depressed.
You mentioned just then that you've developed this engine by yourself, or it's your engine. We were speaking to Dean Hall earlier, and he was heaping praise on it. You've heard this before?
Well, no, he really liked it when he saw it. He was asking me all these questions, and I thought he was maybe criticizing me. He was like, no, generally, I want to know. He was really excited about it. Because like a lot of the kids that come and play, they get really excited about it. And they're kind of like, oh, what's this? Dean Hall was doing that. And not many adults come and play the game and do that. And it was cool to see that he was really excited about it. Somehow he'd completely missed it. I mean, I think we were on the front page of Steam the same time he was, but I guess you get wrapped up in kind of when you're releasing an early access game. I could imagine why he was completely unaware of any other game apart from DayZ at that time.
You said you'd gone through early access. How was that process?
It's pretty fantastic. I mean, I already had a very open development process with my Kickstarter backers. So every few days, you know, I'm always on Twitter. Everyone can always contact me, and I'll answer them back in email or on forums. Steam Early Access was difficult because a lot of people weren't expecting that. And a lot of people have bad opinions of some devs on Early Access who don't put enough updates out or don't talk enough. But I've Since we started, I've put over 70 updates out on Steam. It's only been out 3 months. They're very small updates, but that's the thing. It's small updates keep people interested. If someone has a problem, fix it for them. If it takes if it's a 5 minute fix, I can just do that and put it up online, get feedback on it. Obviously, I've brought the game to the show today, actually not to sell it to people, but to get more feedback, because I can watch people play for the first time, and everyone who's playing is playing it for the first time, and I can immediately see that there are problems with the key bindings, and there are some obvious key bindings that I've just missed out, because I can see people hitting the keys, hoping it to do something, and it doesn't do it, and I can just go, well, that's a 5 minute fix, and that never come up in testing, really, because we kept on ignoring it for more important things. And when people are playing the game, the most important things are the things that are annoying them. So if we can sort them out, we fix the game up. And the game from the early access launch was bugged and it was broken, and the complex AI that I'd written was so complex that it was so bugged that I couldn't tweak it to fix it. And I kind of, people reacted badly to it. But that actually like allowed me to completely just put it back together 3 months later. And you know, we've got a build good enough to show it at a show, and people are really excited about it. We've got a really low bounce rate, only like one in maybe 20 people just sit down, see the tutorial, go ugh, and then quit. Like most people sit down and they play, and some of the people who've been playing like have been playing for like several hours. And I don't have the heart to say that we should probably move them on, or they should see the rest of the games at the show, because they're having a good time. And
okay, so yeah. Where are you in terms of development then? You're constantly iterating, but when do you kind of see being able to draw a line under this and finally say it's out there?
So 0.41 is actually the percentage as well as the milestone that we're hitting. So we're 41% complete. In a few months, we want to hit less than a few months, we want to hit 0.50, which will be the entire sandbox experience nailed down. It may change a bit, but it'll be in a semi kind of late alpha stage. Then over the summer, we're going to kind of polish it up. We've got a full campaign that will be around, hopefully around 10 hours long for people who play it slowly. And that will tell a grand sci-fi story, a very Arthur C. Clarke kind of story. Well, it's a very Arthur C. Clarke kind of story. And it will kind of tell you the story and let you follow the kind of the wider thing. And what it will do is it'll challenge players to try and play the sandbox in different ways. Because being a sandbox, you can do these crazy things, and we want to encourage them to do so. So giving them kind of very different scenarios, giving them like twists and turns and things happening dynamically that they weren't expecting, will be really fun to see how people like react and the testers like it. But yeah, midsummer for some sort of more solid release date. Well, midsummer for the campaign going in. Oh, and because okay. I plan, this is the thing, many people want the 1.0 version, which will be by the end of the summer. But the 1.0 version does not denote completeness in terms of things I'd like to do with the game. It's really in terms of the completeness of the Kickstarter goals, of the original things that I said I would do for the game, getting them all in and done. But I want the game to like grow organically for a long time. My engine I've written is robust enough that we can add new content. And then as soon as it's, you know, properly released, the modding community is going to go nuts. And we've already got people, you know, making new content for the game and the mods, but I haven't released any tools yet for them to do it. They're, you know, hacking files to do it. So once the tools are out, then that will be a whole new kind of lease of life for the game, and maybe bringing more players who might kind of expand on it. And then, who knows, sequel?
Sequel. Well, you're on PC with Steam. Are you Mac as well?
Yeah, Mac and Linux.
Okay, so are there any plans to kind of bring it over to any other platforms? Have you spoken to anybody?
Yeah, well, there are NDAs in the works.
Oh, okay.
There are things that I can talk about. I mean, I do want it working with touchscreens, not specifically touchscreen devices that you might immediately think when I say that. It's probably too intense to run on, say, a small tablet. But there are many like high-end tablets now, so touch interfaces. There are consoles which also have like new input methods and stuff I'd like to work with, but I can't talk about that too much. But the priority is I'll get the game done, then I'll port it to some other things. No point pushing an unfinished game to another platform until it's done.
Well, thank you very much for your time. It's been a pleasure.
Thank you.
Cheers.
Thank you.